Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Gainesville United Methodist Church. Would you all stand? We're going to stand and worship Jesus this morning. We sing sometimes.
Sometimes on this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for grace. And my story isn't over, my story's just begun. Failure won't define me, so that's what my Father does. Failure won't define me, so that's what my Father does. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house. Check your shame at the door. He ain't welcome anymore. Perfect, you just want my heart. If the story isn't over, if the story isn't good, failure's never final when the Father's in the room. Oh, failure's never final when the Father's in the room. Your shame at the door, it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house, yeah. Oh, in His house, holy, praise God.
Prodigals come home, helpless find home. Love's on the move when the Father's in the room. When prison doors ring wide, dead come to life. Singing love is on the move when the Father's in the room.
We sing miracles.
Miracles take place. The cynical find way. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room.
Jericho.
Your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house.
Amen. Praise God. Excuse me, how great.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work
work is finished. The end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Oh, we sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning. Seal the promise, your buried body began to breathe. And out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on
me. Come on, sing that again with truth. It came.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. And out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Oh, Jesus, yours, Jesus, yours is the victory.
Your heads and pray with me this morning. Lord Jesus, we praise you this morning for that work you did on the cross. We praise you for doing something that we didn't deserve. Lord God, you walked up there and you changed our lives forever. And we thank you so much for that, Lord Jesus. We praise you for being our living hope this morning. We praise you for making us new day in and day out, Lord God. Lord God, I pray for this service that amazing things would happen that what happens this morning wouldn't be about us, but it would truly be about you and praising and glorifying you. We love you, Lord God. We pray this in your name. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, Adam. And welcome to Gainesville Church. For those of you who don't know me, if this is your first time here, my name is Benson McGlone. I'm one of the pastors here along with Pastor John. And to everybody who is worshiping with us online, hi. We're glad you're here too. As I stare at a camera, right? Yeah, thank you. Thank you. I've been practicing that move all week. So we do have a few quick connection opportunities, things that are coming up for everybody at this church that are ways for us to be the church, to connect with each other, and just to worship and praise Jesus. The first of which is due to unknown weather, we have moved our barbecue, but combined our barbecue with our church's trunk or treat. And so that is now all happening on October 23rd. That's a Saturday from 4 to 6. It is a community event. Invite your neighbors, invite your friends. There will be candy for the kids, barbecue for the adults. It will be a good time had by all. It is totally free. If you would like to compete against me in having the best trunk, you can do that. There's online signups for reserving a spot to have a trunk, to decorate, theme it, and give away candy. The next thing coming up is Sunday the 24th at 4 o'clock. Our sanctuary choir and Janet and some soloists will be having a bit of a concert, if you will. They will be singing songs of faith. It's called Fall Into Songs of Faith. It's going to be a great time to hear them use their gifts. And then finally, coming up the soonest, Revive House Church, which is our house church network that's part of Gainesville Church, is hosting a night of prayer right here in this sanctuary. That is Saturday the 16th. It goes from 6 to 7. So there will be some worship, there will be some prayer, prayer requests, praying for each other, our needs, our country, the world. We're just going to let the Spirit move in that, but we want to make sure everybody knows that they are invited to that night next Saturday. It will be wonderful and powerful, and we would love to see you all be there. Okay, with that, let me pray, and we will continue to worship God as Pastor John brings us our message. Father, I just thank you. I thank you for this chance to worship you, to be in your presence, to celebrate your goodness and your grace in all of our lives. I thank you for the work of your Spirit, the way that you have drawn people here, the way that you have drawn us together, and just the privilege and the ability you have given us to come before you with praise, with joy, and with celebration as we just acknowledge the fact that you are God. And so, Lord, this morning I ask that you would just pour out your Spirit, an extra portion of your Spirit this morning, Lord, into this place and into Pastor John, that the words he speaks would be your words, and that as he proclaims your biblical truth, Lord, as he proclaims your love and your grace, Father, that our hearts would be open to receiving it, that our lives would be open to receiving it, that it wouldn't just sound good, that we wouldn't just remember it in the time, Lord, but that it would draw us face to face with you, that it would radically change the way we live our lives, and that we would just grow, no matter where we are on this spiritual journey, that we would just grow closer in discipleship to you. We pray all this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thanks, Benson. Benson, how many house churches do we have now?
Nine.
We have nine house churches. We have Louisiana, we have England,
Florida,
Richmond, and five here. So in case you don't know what house church is all about, talk with Benson. He's been doing this now for the better part of 4 years, and it really is a great ministry. It is a great way to reach people who don't feel quite comfortable being in a church. Maybe something's happened to them in the past. If you know somebody like that and you think they might be right for House Church, talk to Benson and let him know. This morning, scripture is found in Matthew's Gospel, the 3rd chapter, beginning with the 13th verse. Listen now to the Word of God. Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John, but John tried to deter him, saying, I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me? Jesus replied, Let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this to fulfill all righteousness. Then John consented. As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And a voice from heaven said, This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. With praise and thanksgiving, this is the Word of God. You know what we're going to talk about this week? I couldn't come up with the title, so it's just that. But I did bring a show and tell. The three sacraments, if you could read this, the three sacraments of the United Methodist Church. Communion, Benson talked about that last week. Baptism and coffee. Those are the three sacraments of the Methodist Church. Baptism, two things I want you to remember. If you remember nothing else, remember these two things. Baptism is an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual grace. Baptism is an outward and visible sign of something that takes place on the inside that is invisible. But it does take place. And it's all about God's grace. That's what baptism is all about. God's grace. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, never meant to be a church, but the movement called the Methodist Church in the early days, he called this a means of grace. It's a place in which God chooses to give his grace in abundance. Baptism. But only if it's done right. And I'm not talking about the mechanics of it. I'm talking about what's in here when baptism takes place. Second thing I want you to remember, if you remember nothing else, second thing, baptism marks the beginning of a journey. The reason why I chose this passage is when Jesus was baptized by John, it started the journey of his public ministry that ended in the cross. That was the beginning of Jesus's ministry. It was the beginning of a journey. Baptism is not an end unto itself. It's not a magic bullet. It contains no magic. It contains grace, but I don't call grace magic. It contains no magic formula. It begins a journey. Now, baptism really does flow nicely out of Judaism because in Judaism, there were lots of ceremonial washings. You would do things to cleanse yourself in order to go worship God or Yahweh in the temple. And these washings took place again and again and again. And you would go into the temple, you would offer sacrifice because of sin, and then you would leave and you would go back out, and there would be more sin in your life. And you would go back in and you would do a ceremonial washing. And sometimes these washings were fully immersion into a body of water, sometimes just washing the hands. Sometimes pouring water over the face. But the trouble was, because there was no ultimate sacrifice, and because sin is an ongoing thing in the human condition, these washings and these sacrifices had to take place again and again until Jesus. You see, Jesus was the ultimate sacrifice. There were no need for any more sacrifices. Once Jesus died on that cross, there was a need for no more sacrifices. None had to be offered. So for Christians, along with no other sacrifice needed, there is one baptism. We are baptized once and only once. Why? Because Jesus' death was sufficient. That sacrifice was all that was needed. So all we have is one baptism. No need to be repeated. No rebaptizing people, because Jesus' sacrifice on the cross was enough. When we are baptized into that sacrifice, that's enough. Now, the meaning of baptism. Oh, I was going to tell you, we are made righteous because of Jesus' death on the cross. Not God just forgets about what we've done wrong, but we're actually made righteous. Now that would take an entire another sermon to go through all of that. And I've been told by Patrick and by Benson and by Sean when he was still here that when I come off a week of vacation, I tend to get very long in the sermon. Neil's nodding his head over here. So I'm resisting the temptation to go into a sermon on justification by faith. So we'll just leave that for another time. But the meaning of baptism, it's all about dying to sin. You know, there are some Episcopalian churches where they have an actual coffin in the sanctuary for a baptism. It's here in the center aisle. The person is immersed into the coffin, as in going into death and raised up into newness of life. Now, it's pretty graphic, but it makes the point. We are dying to the old person, and we're being raised up into newness of life, being new creations, new creatures in Jesus Christ. That's what we're called to be. But make no mistake, we only have the ability to die to sin because of what he did on the cross. That's the only reason we can do it. It is by the grace that comes in baptism that we begin to live differently. We have that outward symbolism of the water being placed on the head or being immersed into a pond or a river, or in this case, next couple of weeks, into a portable hot tub. I'll tell you more about that later. That's what we're going to use for immersion here at the church. Baptism is about acknowledging and repenting my own sinfulness, my own lack of righteousness, my own brokenness. And in that baptism, I also acknowledge that I can do nothing about my sinfulness and my brokenness. I need that outside force. I need that grace that is given because of the death of Jesus on that cross. So baptism is also about repentance. In baptism, we are reminded that Jesus died for us. We're reminded why he died for us. He died for us because we were sinful and broken and out of relationship with our Father, our God, and we needed to be back in relationship with him, and it was by his sacrifice on the cross that all became possible. In baptism, we're reminded of that. In baptism, we confess sin. And here's a place where I think our brothers and sisters across the street do it better than we do. We tend to confess sin in very general terms. Forgive me, Lord, for I'm a sinner. God would like to hear specifics. When they have the confessional, the priest demands specifics. There's something good about that. Because we need to be specific with God when we confess our sins. We tend to do this one. Yes, Lord, I admit I'm a sinner, but so is she. So is he. So is he. I justify myself by the fact that other people are sinful and broken. No, I need to get specific when I confess sin. In baptism, there needs to be that time of confession of sin. In baptism also, it's a time where we make a public declaration. A declaration that we acknowledge Jesus Christ as Son of God. We acknowledge Jesus Christ as the Savior, and we accept him as our Lord and our Savior. We're often reluctant to make statements in public, aren't we? About religion, about faith. If we kept this place here, if we kept our seats here for a couple of extra hours and then up on the big screens instead of the words to the songs, we had the Washington football team on one screen, the Baltimore Ravens on another team. We're not even going to put the Steelers up there. They stink this year. But we would, yeah, I've had to admit that. I really have had to admit that. But there'd be a lot of cheering, a lot of celebrating each touchdown, wouldn't there? We know how to celebrate. We know how to rejoice. Why is it that we struggle to declare our joy and our faith about Jesus? Just give you a scripture that you might want to consider the next time you need to keep your mouth closed about Jesus. Whoever acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge him before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before men, I will disown him before my Father in heaven. We make a public declaration at baptism. Next thing that baptism does is it initiates us into the church community. It's the one great rite of initiation into a church community. We're part of a family. Finally, and I think the most important, most Methodist churches don't talk about the Holy Spirit that much, but we do. We talk about the Holy Spirit a lot here at Gainesville Church. Baptism is also the imparting of the Holy Spirit. Doesn't mean that the person utilizes the Holy Spirit. Doesn't mean that the person relies on the Holy Spirit. It doesn't mean that the person takes comfort, gets courage, gets strength. But the Holy Spirit is given. And it's all because of God's grace. That is the inward grace. Baptism is an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual grace. The Holy Spirit is poured out to the person who is baptized. It's the Spirit that gives us the ability to live out our baptismal vows. That's God's grace in action. It's the Spirit that convicts us when we start to go astray. That's God's grace keeping us from harm. And it's that same Spirit that brings us back. That's the love of God at work in our lives. Baptism is truly an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual grace. But that brings us to a sticky wicket, as the Brits would say. Anybody here a cricket fan? I don't know much about the game. I know you got a batsman, I know you got a bowler, and I know you have this wicket, and there's this thing that sits on the top. If the bowler gets the ball past the batter and it hits the wicket, it will knock that off. Unless, of course, you have a sticky wicket. But we have a sticky wicket here. We have a problem because in the United Methodist Church, in this church in particular, I have baptized far more infants than I have adults. What does an infant have to repent of? Crying too much? Making too many poopy diapers? No. An infant doesn't have much to repent of. In fact, I can say with great conviction standing right here. I have done all of my sinning since I was baptized. All of it. Every sin that I've committed was since I was baptized because I was baptized as an infant. I wrestled with this question before I became a Methodist minister. See, I wasn't going on that track. I was going to become a non-denom pastor. Decided that I wanted to become a part of a denomination, mostly because there was accountability. I'd seen too many non-denom pastors get in big trouble because there was no one to be accountable to. We've got accountability in the United Methodist Church. I like that. But I don't want to go into that either. But I wrestled with this question. This one was very big for me. And I came up with two reasons why I could do infant baptisms and it would still resonate with my theology, my biblical theology. First, infant baptism was practiced in the early church. Our first recorded writing about infant baptism in the church comes from Irenaeus in the second century. He lived from 130 to 202 AD. Irenaeus, I can take a real big leap on this one, and I would almost bet the farm. I doubt that 50, 60 years after John, the Apostle John died, he died in 100. I don't think the church had departed from the teachings of the disciples and from the early church fathers in that short a time. So I think if he's writing about it, it took place in the first century as well. Then also, there's Paul. Paul, wonderfully, I think he might be ADHD. He writes in stream of consciousness. He's writing along and he goes, is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? I'm thankful that I did not baptize any of you except Crispus and Gaius, so no one can say that you were baptized in my name, in parentheses. Yes, I also baptized the household of Stephanas. Kind of like, oh, I don't want to stop. I don't want to rephrase this. I'm just going to keep going. I forgot that one about that household. And I have to assume when you talk about an entire household, there were probably children in that household. So Paul most likely baptized children. Second way that I deal with this is I have always believed in a strong confirmation program. Confirmation is that thing that we do with young people when they get to be 11, 12, 13, depending on maturity, sometimes 14. It's time where they reaffirm or affirm or give evidence of or confirm, as the word says, confirm their belief in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. So we do a very strong confirmation program here. It's a time where we get them to the place where they say, yes, I do repent of my sins. Yes, I do accept Lord Jesus as my, I accept Jesus as Lord and Savior of my life. And it's their decision and their decision alone. If you've had a child in one of my confirmation classes with Bert and with Benson, and before that with Sean, if you've had a kid there, you'll know that the introductory to that confirmation class is with parents and with the kids. And I make one thing very clear. You can make your kid come to confirmation class. You can make them do the lessons. You can make them be on time. I wish more parents would, but you can make them be on time, but you cannot make this decision for them. This is an adult decision. This is their decision. And I will go with that child to a parent and say, no, you cannot force them to stand up here and mouth words. Only had to do it once. Said, she's just not ready. I don't want her to stand up here and lie. She's just not ready to make that statement. So I can deal with infant baptism because of that confirmation process. And like baptism, it's the beginning of a journey. Confirmation is a marker on that road or on that journey. It's not the end of a journey. And I've had people ask me, even some parents, now that my kid's confirmed, does that mean that they can stop coming to church? I even had a parent, I really did. I had a parent ask me that. Does that mean that we as a family can stop coming to church because my kid has been confirmed? No, it's not the end of a journey. It's a marker on that journey. It's a mile marker on that road. Again, that's why I chose the passage about Jesus' baptism. It was that marker that marked the beginning of his journey to the cross. It was the beginning, not an end. For those of you who have had a child baptized, or an infant or a young child, promises are made, aren't they? Promises are made by the parents, and promises are made by the church community. Promises are made that you will raise that child in the church. Promises are made by the church that we will support you. That's why I take babies around when I baptize them. I want to remind all of you that when Bert comes and says in, baby, 12 years, right, Bert? That'd be about sixth grade. 12 years from now, this kid's going to be in youth group, and Bert comes around and says, hey, we need volunteers for youth group. You say, I was there when that child was baptized. Or when Renee comes to you and says, hey, we need help with Sunday school or vacation Bible school. That's what it means to fulfill those baptismal vows as a congregation. That we're there to help those parents fulfill their vows. That they will raise the child in the church. Baptism is a journey. When you baptize a child or an infant, what you're doing is you're signing up for that journey. One of the things that baptism is not, and this is where I do disagree with our friends across the street, I don't believe there's a limbo. In the unfortunate event that a child would die, I believe they go instantly to heaven to be with our Father in heaven. And yet there are still some people that come and they do a good job of convincing me that they really want to be a part of the church. They do a great job of convincing me that this baptism is very important to them. And I baptize their kid and I never see them again. They've checked the box just in case there is limbo. They made sure that their kid got baptized. It saddens my heart when that happens because they're not putting that child on that journey. They're not giving them a chance to affirm the vows that were taken in their name at their baptism. Now, you've heard these statistics before, but I'm going to throw them out again. And you can quibble with these statistics. You can run them through your mind and say, my kid doesn't do this to the extent you're talking about, but the differential in the numbers is so great, you'll see what I'm talking about. If your child Watch as the average number of hours spent on social media, on TV, going to the movies, playing video games, it's 5 hours per day. If they start at the age of five doing this, obviously 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 are going to be less than that five, but once you get to the teenage years, it could be 6, 7, 8 hours a day. If they do that, and you can quibble with the numbers, if they do that average, by the time they're 18, they'll have spent over 24,000 hours on social media and video games and TV and movies. And if that same child starts at the age of five and goes the 6.5 hours every day to public school, 180 days, they'll have over 15,000 hours spent in school. Now, neither of these places are going to promote Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Neither of these places are going to be speaking about him. And if they do, especially in TV and the movies, it's usually in a negative fashion. 24,000 hours, 15,000 hours. And if you bring your child to Sunday school 52 weeks every year from the time they are 3 to the time they are 18, they'll have less than 800 hours of Christian education. I was a biology major. You know what they taught me? That's a rigged experiment. That's a rigged experiment. My giving them exposure to so little. You see, baptism is the beginning of a journey for the parent to raise that child in the church so that when it comes time for them to affirm and confirm their relationship or the vows that were taken in their name, they've got a fighting chance. They've got a fighting chance to say, yes, I know this Jesus. Yes, I love this Jesus. Yes, I want to follow this Jesus and be confirmed. A couple of weeks, we're going to have a very special, special week. We have put it off. It was supposed to be today, and then Benson and I were talking, and there are some logistical things that we've got to get right. First of all, we need to build something here to surround that inflatable portable hot tub that we're going to use for immersion, or else you guys will soak the sanctuary. Can't have that. Probably need to take this first pew out as well. So we've got some things to work out. Oh yeah, that's right. We got to remind you that if you do want to be, if you've never been baptized, or if you want to reaffirm your baptismal vows with immersion, you probably need to bring a second set of clothes. Because we're probably going to do this near the beginning of the service, and you don't want to sit there in the dirty, in the wet clothes. No, you can't do that. I said dirty. It was one of those Freudian slips. You can't come and do your laundry. I'm sorry. Don't wear your dirtiest clothes so that you can get them washed. And no, not going to have that. But we're going to have this very, very special Sunday. And we've got a card that's in the back of the pews. I'd like to see all of you take it out and look at it for a moment. It's got a number of options on that card. I would like to speak to Pastor John with a pastor about giving my life to Jesus and baptism. I'm making the decision to follow Jesus and have never been baptized and would like to be baptized. I've already given my life to Jesus but have never been baptized. Please tell us how you would like to be baptized. We're going to go through all of it. We're going to let you have that choice. And then the next one is, I'm going to add to this, my life is kind of slid away from God, from Jesus and church. I'd like to rededicate my life to Jesus Christ. There are three ways that you can handle this card this morning. You can take it home with you and pray about it. You can take it, fill it out today, and you can put it in that basket that is back there in the narthex or the lobby. Who knows what a narthex is anymore? I don't think I do anymore. You can raise your hand. You all raise your hand. I've kind of forgotten. It's a lobby, and you can put it in that. And then if you want to make a public statement that you're saying something, you can bring it up and put it in here. The way this is going to work, I'm going to pray here in a few moments, and I'm going to ask you to prayerfully consider what God would have you do with this card. My goodness, we're starting to sound Baptist. No, no, no. If we were Baptist, I'd have an altar call right now. And you all would come up to the front, and we've had the baptismal font fully. It would be filled right now, and we'd be baptizing you right away. No. We want you to prayerfully consider this. So during our time of prayer, I want you to pray about that. I also like you to pray about what's going on in our country. I saw a newspaper article in the USA Today, and it says that by 2030, or maybe it's 2035, the nuns will outnumber every religion. Now, I'm not talking about nuns that wear the penguin costume. I'm talking about those who have no affiliation whatsoever with Judaism, Christianity, or Islam. They'll outnumber the people who do. Think about that for a moment, what that means for this country. Those who don't affiliate with any of the three major religions will outnumber those who do. And even now, only 17% of the people who say they affiliate with Christianity actually participate in worship and in the church. It's a changing landscape. So I want you to pray very seriously after you pray about what you should do with this card. I'm going to ask you to pray for revival in our churches and awakening in our country. Then finally, pray for yourselves. Pray for yourself. The way we're going to do it, if you do want to bring the cards up, the band is going to play the closing song. They're going to play until they get to the bridge. Adam is going to invite you to stand. But all during that time, where we're seated, if you want to come forward and put a card in this basket, feel free to do so then. So let's bow our hearts and heads in prayer. Lord, right now, in silence, we're praying for revival in your church and awakening in our land. Lord, we also pray for ourselves. We pray what to do with that card. We ask you to assess where we are on that journey of becoming more like you, Jesus, more like you each day. So, Lord, we pray for ourselves that you would strengthen us by your Spirit. Give us the courage to step out into that journey. Lord, give us the honesty to admit to where we are broken and sinful. And finally, Lord, I pray for those needs within this congregation, for those who are hurting, for those who are sorrowful, those who are dealing with struggles that no one else knows about. I pray for healing, for you are a God of miracles. You are a God of miracles. In Jesus' name.
We're going to sing this next song. I'm going to invite you to stay seated and keep just kind of focusing on those cards. Pray about them, whatever it may be. Maybe you don't do anything at all, but just take this time to think that over with God. Every song we could ever sing, worthy of all praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say,
worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Oh, holy, there is no one. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around. Sing all day. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in love to those around me.
Stand and sing this together. Stand as a church and sing, I will build my life.
Oh, and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you. Put my trust in you alone.
told this in the middle of the sermon. I didn't know how much time I would have, so I do have time now. Small town, there's a Baptist minister, a Baptist preacher, a Methodist minister, and a Catholic priest. They all had problem, same problem. They all had steeples, and up in that steeple in the belfry, there were squirrels. They couldn't get rid of them. They were talking on one Monday morning after a Sunday that was disturbed in all three churches by those squirrels. They said, "What have you tried to do?" "Well, I've gotten a humane trap, and I take them down to the local park, and they beat me back. Then I took the humane trap, and I took them 5 miles out of town, and still they came back." And they were talking to the Baptist minister, and the Catholic priest were saying they tried everything. Methodist minister said, "I solved it." He said, "What'd you do?" "I baptized them, I confirmed them, and I never saw them again." Baptism and confirmation are not that. It's a journey. If we have gotten off that road, let's make it a time to get back on. And let's pray for revival. Do you know that every time there's been a revival anywhere in the world or an awakening, it's always started with a few people. Sometimes as few as two praying. Let's pray for revival. Let's pray for awakening. Go in peace.